Preface. This translation of Tanakh, the Holy Scriptures, produced by the Jewish Publication Society, was made directly from the traditional Hebrew text into the idiom of modern English. It represents the collaboration of academic scholars with rabbis from the three largest branches of organized Jewish religious life in America. Begun in 1955, the ongoing translation was published in three main stages: the Torah in 1962, the Prophets, Nevi'im, in 1978, and the Writings, Ketuvim, in 1982. These three volumes, with revisions, are now brought together in a complete English Tanakh, Torah, Nevi'im, Ketuvim, the latest link in the chain of Jewish Bible translations. On the history of Bible translation. Bible translation began about 2,200 years ago, in the 3rd century BCE, as the large Jewish population of Alexandria, Egypt, came under the influence of Hellenism. When the Greek language replaced Hebrew and Aramaic as their vernacular, and the Torah in its Hebrew original was no longer commonly understood, a translation into Greek was made for the Jewish community of Alexandria. This translation came to be known as the Septuagint, Latin for 70, because of the legend that the committee of translators numbered 72, six elders from each of the 12 tribes of Israel. In the last few centuries BCE, the Jews who lived to the north and east of Judea also found the Hebrew Bible difficult to understand, for their spoken language had become largely Aramaic. Translations into Aramaic, first of the Torah and then of the rest of the Bible, became known as the Targums. The Septuagint and the Targums are not only the oldest translations of the Bible, but also the most influential. Down to our own day, virtually every Christian translation has followed the methods of the Jewish translators who created the Septuagint, and generally followed their renderings of the Hebrew as well. The Christian translators also were influenced by the interpretation of the Hebrew text set forth in the Targums, much of it in oral form at the time, and by the writings of the Jewish philosopher-interpreter Philo of Alexandria, who died about 45 CE. The forerunners and leaders of the Renaissance and the Reformation, 14th, 15th centuries, and especially Martin Luther and William Tyndale, 16th century, made use of Latin translations of the classic Jewish commentators Rashi, Ibn Ezra, and Kimchi, 11th to 13th centuries, whose works were imbued with the direct knowledge of the Targums. Luther was greatly indebted to Nicholas of Lyre, 1270 to 1349, who had adopted Rashi's exegesis for his Latin Bible commentary. Rashi's influence on all authorized and most unofficial English translations of the Hebrew Bible becomes evident when Tyndale's dependence on Luther is considered. Tyndale is central to many subsequent English translations: the King James Version of 1611, the British Revised Version of 1881 to 1885, the American Standard Version of 1901, and especially the Revised Standard Version of 1952. Alongside the close literal method of Bible translation, the earliest Jewish translators were also influenced by the widely held view that, along with the written law, Torah Shebichtav, God had given Moses on Mount Sinai an oral law, Torah Shebaal Peh, as well, so that to comprehend God's Torah fully and correctly, it was essential to make use of both. Thus, when a translation of the Hebrew Bible into the Judeo-Arabic vernacular was deemed necessary for Jewry in Muslim countries, toward the end of the first millennium, the noted philologian, philosopher, and community leader Saadia Gaon, 882-942, produced a version that incorporated traditional Jewish interpretation, but was not based on word-for-word translation. At the same time, it was a model of clarity and stylistic elegance. The present version is in the spirit of Saadia. With the growth of Christianity in the first century, the Church adopted the Septuagint as its Bible, and the Septuagint was translated into the languages of the various Christian communities. As Greek began to give way to Latin in the Roman Empire, it was only a matter of time before a Latin translation of Scripture became the recognized Bible of the Church. The Church Father Jerome, circa 340 to 420, produced the official Latin version. Drawing on Jewish tradition and consulting Jewish teachers, he achieved what came to be known as the Vulgate, the Bible in the language of the common people. The Vulgate, the Bible of European Christianity until the Reformation, is clearly the most significant Bible translation after the Septuagint. With the rise of Protestantism in Europe, scholars within this movement set themselves the task of making the Bible available in the various vernaculars of the time. By 1526, the first parts of two notable translations began to appear: Martin Luther's in German and William Tyndale's in English. The latter, by way of several subsequent revisions, became the King James Version of 1611. The more modern English versions, such as the Holy Scriptures by the American rabbi Isaac Leeser, 1855, the British Revised Version, 1881 to 1885, the American Standard Version, 1901, the Jewish Publication Society's The Holy Scriptures, 1917, and the American Revised Standard Version, 1952, made extensive use of the King James. On the making of the new translation. After World War II, when the Jewish Publication Society began to consider a new edition of the Bible, the idea of a modest revision of the 1917 translation met with resistance, and the concept of a completely new translation gradually took hold. The proposed translation would reproduce the Hebrew idiomatically and reflect contemporary scholarship, thus laying emphasis upon intelligibility and correctness. It would make critical use of the early rabbinic and medieval Jewish commentators, grammarians, and philologians, and would rely on the traditional Hebrew text, avoiding emendations. The need for this new translation was the focus of the Jewish Publication Society's annual meeting in 1953. Later that year, the Society announced its intention to proceed with the project, and in 1955, the Committee of Translators began their task. Harry M. Orlinsky, professor of Bible at Hebrew Union College, Jewish Institute of Religion, New York, was asked to serve as editor-in-chief for the new translation, along with H. L. Ginsberg, professor of Bible at the Jewish Theological Seminary, and Ephraim A. Spicer, professor of Semitic and Oriental Languages at the University of Pennsylvania, as fellow editors. Associated with them were three rabbis, Max Arst, Bernard J. Bamberger, and Harry Friedman, representing the conservative, reform, and orthodox branches of organized Jewish religious life. Solomon Grazel, editor of the Jewish Publication Society, served as secretary of the committee. The committee profited much from the work of previous translators. The present rendering, however, is essentially a new translation. A few of its characteristics may be noted. The committee undertook to follow faithfully the traditional Hebrew text, but there were certain points at which footnotes appeared necessary. 1. Where the committee had to admit that it did not understand a word or passage. 2. Where an alternative rendering was possible. 3. Where an old rendering, no longer retained, was so well known that it would very likely be missed, in which case the traditional translation was given in the name of Others, usually referring to the Society's version of 1917. 4. Where the understanding of a passage could be facilitated by reference to another passage elsewhere in the Bible. And 5. Where important textual variants are to be found in some of the ancient manuscripts or versions of the Bible. The translators avoided obsolete words and phrases and, whenever possible, rendered Hebrew idioms by means of their normal English equivalents. For the second person singular, the modern you was used instead of the archaic thou, even when referring to the deity, you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.